Hi everyone, welcome to our webinar. I'm Nick Bonici, I'm the marketing manager for GOctopus and Kathy, and I'd just like to say thank you for joining us today. We'll just give it one or two more minutes to give everybody time to join, and then we'll get started. Okay, so once again, thank you very much for joining our webinar. Today you'll be hearing from the Technical Director of GOctopus, Emilio Nicolini, and over the next 45 minutes or so, he's going to be covering an introduction to GOctopus. Then we'll be focusing on pile driving monitoring, what it is, why it shouldn't be overlooked, and the value that it can add to projects. And finally, he's going to give you some case studies to bring it all to life. At the end, there should also be some time for questions. So if you do have any throughout, please just use the Q&A panel down the right-hand side and they'll come directly through to us. Okay, so without further ado, I'll hand over to my colleague, Emilio.
Thank you. Thank you, Nick, for this introduction, and thank you everyone to attend for attending to this webinar. I'll be quickly going to the slides. We will discuss how we can add value to projects with pile driving monitoring. What we will cover today in this webinar, we will carry out a short introduction to GOctopus. We will then speak about what pile driving monitoring, what it is, how and where it can be carried out, what does it entail. Then we will discuss how about using PDM in a project, and we'll present a couple of projects we worked on as a case histories, and then there will be indeed space for your questions. So who we are, what we do. GOctopus, we are specialists in carrying out and performing testing of deep foundations, and we are part of the CATI group, and we have over 15 years of experience in the pile driving monitoring field and testing onshore, nearshore, offshore, and underwater. We come from the offshore oil and gas industry, but we've exported our experience into the offshore wind, where we have adapted the methodology to the specific needs of this industry. GOctopus is able to take care of the whole process of the pile testing process. The engineering for the preparation of the test, the definition of the methodology, the logistics and installation of the sensors, and then the management and the execution of the test itself on site, and then finally the interpretation of the obtained results. We have a very long experience, a reliable team of experts, which will take care of every step of the testing. We will go and carry out silently the test while you are working and in between the ongoing activities. We will make sure that you will not be losing time thanks to the pile driving monitoring, and you will be able to focus on your activity without distraction to stay on your schedule. And to do this, we can provide the best equipment available and an optimized method to use it. We carry out pile driving monitoring and pile dynamic testing. We can, in cases where required, carry out static load testing, axial and lateral, and we can carry out as well structural monitoring and many other solutions that you can check through our website with the instruments from PDI. Let's go now more in deep discussing and explain what is PDM, how it works in particular. To introduce this, we can start from the basics and compare it with a static test. To carry out a static test, you have first of all to install your pile, which for in this case is a driven pile, and then you have to load it by applying a load statically, which should mimic the real load that the pile shall carry. And this is done by loading the pile with a structure on it, and then to measure the displacement. And then you interpret the results. Results are expressed in this plot where you have here the load, and then you here have the displacement, and you measure the points according to load and the relevant displacement. And when you have all your tests done, you plot all the results and you interpret. There are various methodologies, and then you have the value of your test load. But this requires a lot of actions to be done. You need to build a test. There is a structure to build around it, which is a hard work and heavy duty job. And then you have to follow your test, which is long and complex, because you have to protect all the instruments. You have to protect the pile from sun, from wind, from rain, from everything. And then you are forced to work in a quite complicated environment with instruments, cables, and so on, which makes life a bit complicated. On the contrary, pile driving monitoring and pile dynamic testing, how is it working? Essentially, you're pushing your pile in the soil by means of a hammer. The hammer is a dropping mass which hit the pile at the head. And by this hit, you have a compressive wave that travels down the pile and which is causing the pile to advance. So the advancement of the pile into the soil is the repetition, is due to the repetition of these actions. And this way, actually, at each blow, to let the pile advance in the soil, you are finally testing your pile at each blows. And this is what we take advantage of by the PDM. To represent how this works, we can summarize that there is a compressive wave which is traveling down the pile. We schematized in this movie here. And while the pile is advancing, the soil is reacting and is reflecting back something. And this is causing the pile globally to advance. And indeed, if the pile were rigid, you could have written some equation to say that globally the energy is dissipated in the soil by means of friction, base capacity, and you can obtain something that takes that can allow you to calculate by means, for example, of the final displacement obtained. But as a matter of fact, this is a very rough approximation of what reality is in the pile, and this is providing not very accurate results. And this is why, for example, most of the standards traditionally don't like really this kind of formulae, which are not really accepted. What is happening and how we take advantage of this with our instrumentation? We said during each blow, there is a compressive wave which is traveling down the pile, and that some of that energy is reflected back. So we can measure this by applying instruments here. We will see later which kind of instrument, and measuring here what happens and taking advantage of how the wave is transformed. I did a simple movie here. You will see there's the pile wave traveling down, the wave is transforming, is coming back. And if we put instruments here, this is what we measure in time. As you see, it's not necessary to go in the details, but just you can see that the wave that is going down is coming back, and it is a sort of transformed. And by this transformation, we take advantage to interpret what is happening at the pile soil interface. As you see, we install accelerometers, we install strain gauges at the pile top, and these sensors allow to record this wave traveling up and down, and it's not as simple as in the previous slide. As you can see, there is a lot of technicalities to interpret it, but this is really providing a good estimate of the actual bearing capacity. The instruments can be bolted and are firmly installed on the pile to get the acceleration and the displacement and the deformation of the steel. And they are normally bolted with a screw, and it requires to drill holes in the pile. In some cases, in particular for the offshore wind industry, we can provide also another solution for installing the instruments, which is providing supports. Because in many cases you can't drill holes on the pile. In cases a bit more demanding, we can even find other kinds of solutions which are providing when you cannot use supports is involving glued sensors. We can glue the sensor on the pile, and this technique is very promising, is still under development. It's been used with good results and just requires to be designed on a case-by-case basis. And it also requires a mix of different technologies to record the acceleration and the strains. And it involves part of the sensor, of the sensors by using the fiber optic techniques. And for that we use what we think is the best equipment with our provider Silex. So which are the practical results of PDM? In summary, by instrumenting the pile during driving or during the testing, you will have an estimate of the actual bearing capacity. You will have the elements to accept and certify the pile in a very robust, quick, and very low impact and cost way. You have as well the accurate data to monitor the correct behavior of the hammer, which is fundamental if you experience difficult driving or hard driving, because our sensors are certified and kept certified for each operation activity, so they can provide accurate measurement. And in some of the more complicated and complex cases, you will be able to protect your pile from damages due to the stress, which could be greater than predicted, and you can check it during driving. Think for example to the control you could have to keep the fatigue damage under control. And then you can also try to protect the pile from possible problems related to the tip buckling. Advantages, benefits, and value it adds to your project. The advantages with respect in particular to a static test are very important. For example, the major advantage you have is that you don't need essentially other equipment on site. You need only the hammer, the pile, and our instrumentation. You don't need beams, anchor piles, heavy ballast weight to be added to the test. The test, another point, is that it's done during installation and at the end. And the results are available in very short time. It can be 6 hours or 40 hours, 8 hours, depend how the field is organized, how many people are available to assist the test. And indeed, as well, regarding also the type of piles. In very particular cases where the capacity could not be available at the end of the testing and couldn't be predicted in the long term, you could need a restrike test, which is in any case gets the system less complicated and time consuming than a static test. Indeed, if you go offshore, this advantage increases more and more because working on site in offshore, it's complicated. So when you go offshore, it's in many cases, in most of the cases, it is the only viable option, and you strictly need to bring PDM and PDT testing equipment with you. But in general, why should we test a pile? What is the advantages of testing a pile? We try to summarize in two cases. There could be an advantage in a design stage and then during installation at the installation stage. But in any case, why should we test a pile in these two cases? Because you can say that at case A, for example, in design stage, engineering methods are normally using to design piles, which are based on past experience, literature, standards. Then pile design needs to be completed before going on site for the installation. You need to buy the material, sign contracts. So we wonder with you, what's the use of PDM here? At the same time, if pile is designed and built by and then to be installed by a contractor, it's probably indeed even paid, and that point can't be changed. You have to install it if you are a contractor, but it's not the PDM itself which is helping you to install the pile. It's not adding energy to the hammer. And this is particularly true, for example, in the case of offshore wind with more transformer station with skirts piles, for example, but also for the monopile themselves. So what is the benefit of testing here? Well, there are several elements that can confirm the need and the value of the PDM. And to present this, we took advantage of the fact that waves that we use to measure the actual capacity are moving in time and space. So we wanted to present our opinion in this fashion. So there's a possible advantage in time, and there is a possible advantage in position, meaning how and from which point you see the installation of a pile and the PDM. Benefits in time. You have to think that, and you know that the worst problems always arrive at the worst time. What do we mean here? Imagine your pile was designed, is installed, and the structure is put on service. But in particular, in the offshore wind, if you don't test your pile, you'll discover that the pile is not working, it's not okay. Only once the first and big environmental load arrives, so the tempest or whatever, and at that time the pile will be mobilized to what it should be and should have been designed to. And you will discover that only at that point. So PDM is an investment in safety and in time, because testing and certifying your pile today with the test is providing you with a safe future along the service life of the structure. You will be certain that the pile is providing what is requiring across the service life. Another point that you can take advantage of is that you can always improve what you do. And as a company or contractor, if you're using PDM as part of the construction process, this will give you an invaluable database of very reliable, strong data to, on one side, improve your methods, because you can compare results with the prediction carried out with the methods you're using. And then it can refine, for example, the prediction of the soil resistance to driving, which is the behavior of the pile and the hammer, and improve this. You can reduce, for example, the size of your pile or increase it to have the installation quicker. So it's also able, which is not secondary, to grow the confidence in the design methods you use. So in future projects, you will be able to really push your boundaries and save money on your future projects. If you see benefits in space, so according to the position from which you look at the project, if you, for example, are a wind energy operator, indeed, at the end for you, a wind farm is an investment, because that shall provide revenues in time or to be sold to others. And you pay a designer, a contractor, and essentially you want your farm to work. But if tomorrow along the life of the pile, one of the pile fails, you will be indeed involved in claims in with lower your lawyers and in that time, most probably the wind farm will not be allowed to work. So that is loss of money in terms of lack of production or delays in the financial return of your investment. So in our opinion, in this sense, PDM allows you to have the means to take action if there's anything which is not working from the beginning. And this will help to avoid risk and to discover that this risk comes unpredicted when you are not prepared to. At the same time, if you are a contractor, you see from the opposite side, and then for you, it's wind farm is a building activity and you want to it to go ahead rapidly, smoothly as possible. And you have a structure to be installed, piled, completed and handed over. So as well, testing of pile might simply be a part of your contract. At that time, if it is not part of your contract, but in any case, if one of the pile fails, you also could be involved and you will most probably be involved in claims. So again, lawyers and complications. And in the other case, if simply the pile is testing is part of your contract, they will allow your structure to be approved quickly and smoothly and in the shortest time. So you will at that point need a method which is providing results quickly and safely and without surprises. So PDM is the right solution because it is allowing you to certify your foundation easily, rapidly, and with no major time delays. In conclusion, there's a number of benefits which can be added by PDM to your project, and especially where offshore pile need testing, PDM is the only economically viable methodology because it is providing assurance of the real available pile capacity with the modern technology. It gives also confidence in the soil model globally. It is allowing you to complete the structure with certain data about its future behavior. And it is solving also the requirement of certification of the structure and foundation in a robust, quick, and low cost and low impact way. It lets you as well confirm the predicted soil behavior and the pile behavior to guarantee the performance of the design and of the installation planning. So these are very important advantages for us. And how to achieve, in our opinion, the maximum benefit from PDM. During design, it is our opinion that you should include PDM in the design process, because at that time you can fix the objective of the PDM, you can identify the limitations and in case modify your project accordingly. And the idea is that to avoid impacting on your schedule and provide the maximum information you can get from PDM from the beginning in a planned way. Once you are on site, what you have to achieve, you have to avoid failures of the equipment. If you take that into account in your procedure, you can do that. And to avoid PDM to impact on your schedule. These two elements will allow you to essentially carry out the test seamlessly and very quickly. So I don't know if there's any questions at the moment on this part. Otherwise, I can carry on. I don't see any questions. They will come, I hope, later. And no. Oh yes, there are questions. I can see those. About boulders, there's one of the attendees which is actually asking if there's a way with PDM to detect the position of large boulders. It depends of what you mean, the position of the boulder along the pile base. It's not really very possible at the moment, at least. Indeed, with PDM, you can understand if you hit something because the signal is changing. It depends on the size, and it depends also of the strength of this boulder. And it depends as well how the pile is reacting, because if the pile, for example, is buckling due to this large boulder, the pile could not exactly show this at the pile head. So it depends how the pile is designed. In some cases, we can do something. We are studying this. There's the second of the case histories which is discussing this, so we can go in a bit in deeper at that point. Yes, the presentation will be shared. You will see also a recording, if I'm not wrong. And PDM is indeed applicable to onshore projects. Indeed, it's very common to use it. And it is indeed applicable to concrete-driven piles. It's very well behaving also on in precast concrete piles and in the cast on site drilled, for example, concrete piles. It is just requiring to take into account the fact that you will be testing dynamically from the beginning, because you could in some cases be required to add some rebars in the piles because of the tensile wave that is in some cases traveling up, but this is very simple to calculate. We can provide you the elements to do that. PDM is not actually, there's a question asking if PDM is recommended in standards for the offshore wind. How many piles do you instrument in an offshore wind farm? Normally, it depends. It's 5 to 10%. It depends on which standard you use. PDM is not strictly recommended by the standards, but it is very often required by the certification authorities, which require that you prove that the pile is designed as required to for the lifetime of the structure. And in any case, as we just discussed, it's something which is adding value to your project. And the number of piles that you test can be optimized indeed. And this is discussed in the first case history, because indeed one of the way you can take advantage, for example, by providing testing on the pile, is that coefficients that you use in the interpretation according, for example, to the Eurocode can be improved according to the number of piles which are tested. And this is in many cases allowing for a quicker approval of the piles. I don't see other questions. Oh, yes, there are questions. Can you elaborate on the advantages of our PDM system compared to the system of any competitors? So, yes, I can. It is essentially our track record which is replying to this question. We are very good feedbacks from our clients. Our instruments are certified. We have high quality instrumentation at the origin, and also we in the years we developed our own way of installing the instruments, which is not just as I showed you screwing something on the pile. It is requiring a lot of attention in how you connect the cables and how you guarantee, for example, that all the connection between cables and instruments are guaranteed, for example, for water tightness, which is not a simple way. There is also other elements, which are how you take care of the certification of the instruments. There's also regarding the range of operations of your instruments. There's a lot of instruments where and sensors in particular, which have a very tight band of operation. Our instruments have a very wide operativity band, so we are using those exactly for this reason. Another question is about vibrated piles. Yes, this technique can be as well used for vibrated piles. So we just finished to use it in a very decent project. The pile was instrumented, and we were able to get a lot of information about vibrating the pile, how vibration work, how you can reduce the vibro driving resistance. There's a lot of information that you can gain by means of our instrument, and even in particular in vibrated piles. About pile tip buckling, there's an example, so we can discuss that later. PDM for piles socketed in rock, quite interesting question. It can be done. It only requires to be taken into account the behavior of the rock, and it's necessary a particular procedure to be simple and straight. PDM is making an assumption, which is that the soil is not losing and its resistance during driving, so it is not fragile. And if it is losing resistance, it can recover that resistance. This is the basis of testing the pile and driving the pile. In case you have a socketed pile in the rock, at that point the pile will be drilled and grouted, and you just have to be careful to set up the PDM testing in order not to break the rock and not to break the grout. So it will not be testing your pile to the ultimate capacity, because that will require to go towards the failure, but you can proof test your pile. So you can adapt the PDM and the PDT technique to prove the capacity, for example, for the SLS cases, if we want to speak a bit technically. So it can be done. It has been done. It is just requiring some attention in how you carry out the testing on site. Is this a nice to have reassurance for installation contractor? I think we elaborated this part of the presentation. It is not just a nice to have reassurance, because as I said, we make the hypothesis, which is most of all psychological hypothesis, that the methodologies we use are working, which is the case in most of the cases, luckily, but it's not in all cases. There are cases in which the piles did not behave as predicted. So it is not simply a nice to have thing, but it is something which is required more and more, because you have to prove that the design methods that you are using are really providing the correct capacity. And this is becoming day by day more required, because as we all know, the methodologies that we use to design the piles are becoming more and more sophisticated, to try to get the correct and the real capacity of the piles without too many over design. And this indeed is a great advantage for the design, but it brings you in an area where you really are designing piles to their limit. So from this, testing is becoming day by day necessary and necessary. I think there's no more questions for the moment. So I would, if you don't mind, I will present you a couple of case histories. The first one is what we did for a typical transformer platform, which is a heavy structure. And in this case, it's been provided skirt piles, which required underwater pile dynamic monitoring. And the goal was to estimate the pile capacity at the end of the driving, and in case, if necessary, to address strikes to prove the capacity as required by the Eurocode. Piles were 2.4 diameter and 82.3 meters long. And the hammer was a reasonably big one. It was this hammer IHCS 2500. And our client needed the acceptance at the end of the installation. They needed that before demobilizing the equipment. And it was strictly required that that was proved with the methodology that was to be submitted to the BSH. So, and the client told us that the piles were really pushed at its limit during design correctly to adapt and to use the best methodologies available on the market. So our proposal to the client, so was obviously to use PDM to monitor the pile during the driving, but in a very particular way, it is how we operate. And that required to prepare an operative procedure to avoid any discussions on site, any decision to be taken on site. And this procedure regarded establishing exactly how to interpret the PDM data, how to estimate the capacity, and then included the exact procedure to include and to elaborate the results according to the Eurocode. And this procedure accounted as what was predictable could happen on site. So it detailed how to estimate the capacity at the end of driving by means of PDM. It took into account and explained how to take into account the number of tested piles to reduce and to change the material factors to be used to estimate the capacity of the pile. It detailed how to take into account results of the PDM and PDT to estimate the expected long-term capacity. And according to this, it also detailed how to improve that estimate with restrikes, and detailing exactly the formulae, the decision to be taken, and the times to be and the wait times to be taken into account. So this practically what has been requiring to include a forecast of all the possible cases that could happen on site, include a detailed procedure on how to use the PDM to estimate the capacity, the procedure as well, for example, to estimate the resistance in tension to avoid discussion, to avoid interpretation. This was detailed in this procedure. And as well, it included a list of actions to be carried out on site depending on the PDM results that you have progressively during the activity. So what about the capacity available, need of restrike, the wait times for the strikes, how to use restrikes to improve the estimate, and then how to project the data in terms of the long-term capacity. All this was detailed with tables An example is provided here without numbers. Apologies. And so there was a sort of multiple choice structures in this procedure with the tables with numbers that you can check and compare on site. And this allowed to have the procedure allowed with no applied, sorry, with no issues. We needed some restrikes, but this was organized. It's been kept to the minimum possible. And so our client was happy, we were happy, everyone was happy. And this confirmed that our methodology was good. And among those ideas in that procedure, there was something related on how to estimate. As you can see here, this is literature data. There's a big variability among the gain in capacity in time of the pile. And we included in that procedure how to select among this area where the pile capacity was going. And we are happy to see that PDM has been recently included in a joint industry project, which is led by CATI, where PDM data is particularly taken into account because it's providing reliable and very sophisticated results to allow to study how the capacity is progressing with time. The second case history is regarding something about the pile tip buckling. And pile tip buckling is a very annoying problem. We can definitely say that because it is exposing the pile to damage. In some cases, in many cases, this damage is actually totally unnoticed, and in some cases is not providing any problem to the pile. You will see later why. And pile tip buckling is essentially here. This is the results of some numerical analysis we are carrying out to study how we can try to see that by means of our instruments. It's as you see, as the pile is advancing, this is a numerical analysis where you have a rock layer, which is opposing to the pile advancement. And this is the deformation in this large strain numerical analysis that you can see here. And another very annoying effect is that if you have a boulder, you can see that here, it's opposing as well to the pile penetration, and the pile, instead of stopping, is simply deforming. And this deformation can then propagate along the pile with very annoying consequences. So as we said, it can happen because of hard layers, as it is here. It can happen even if there's a dense sand in any case, and diameter to thickness ratio are too high. And it can happen if you have boulders or something like that. It's really a very subtle and annoying problem. This is an image that many of you most probably know. It's been a shocking image published in 2017. And this is what has a very rare thing where piles were recovered in a port after many years after the installation. And this was the result of that demolition. And so pile buckling is unfortunately real. This happens simply by driving the piles in a dense sand. So imagine what can happen if you have boulders or rock layers. And no one noticed that. So this is why we know pile tip buckling is a real problem. How to cope with that? We have to admit at the moment there's no definite solution to this, because even the PDM cannot really observe what happens at at the pile base. We think it can, but there's no methodology at the moment, and we have an open project on this, which luckily enough is starting to provide some results. But essentially, we can, on the contrary, observe if there is an overstressing of the base. We can observe this from the top. And as well, we can observe if there's something strange happening at some point at the base, because this will change the signature of the signal, and we can detect if there's hard reflections of the wave from the base. And this is something that we can do. Not all the cases at the moment are detected, and this is indeed an industry problem, and we are working on that. There is a line of research which is open. What we can do now? Now, what we can do at the moment is that we can monitor the pile blow by blow and getting at each blow information about what is the level of stress that we can correlate with what happens at the base. We measure at the top, but we know how to correlate the stress at the base. So by measuring what happens at the top, we can estimate quite accurately what is supposed to happen at the base. And then there is a modification of the signal coming back from the base, which happens if the base starts to react too much during penetration. We look at these two things in parallel during driving. There is a way that we invented to represent that data, that two data, by means of a point in a plot like this. And these results, which are a bit too complicated to expose to you now, but in any case, we can define areas where you don't have problems, could have problems, have indeed problems. And this is allowing to modify, for example, the pile energy, reducing it, and to adapt what you do to avoid to enter in a risky area. It's not a completely 100% fail-safe method, but when we adopted that because the client was worried about a possible pile tip buckling in cases, for example, where drilled piles and grouted piles were required, and by applying this methodology, everything worked well. The pile was undamaged. They were able to fix the pile in the hard soil before starting drilling, and everything went for the best. So it's not totally solved, but the way we do that and the way PDM can be applied is at least reducing significantly the risk that you have an unnoticed pile tip buckling at the base. Last but not least, actually the case histories were three, not two. And I'm happy of the question that came to us during this presentation. Yes, we can apply vibro instruments and our sensors to vibro-driven piles. This is allowing you to take many information, surprisingly interesting, about how the vibro driving work. And basically you get stresses, you get accelerations, and by means of that you can measure where the energy goes into the pile. You can have the means to calculate, for example, how the hammer is behaving, if it is delivering all the energy. It can provide you the elements to estimate how much the resistance to penetration is reduced by the vibro installation itself. And so this is still under development, because it is not exactly the same thing as driving piles by impact hammer, but it's very promising at the moment. We applied successfully and with satisfaction of ourselves and in particular of the client. And we discovered really a lot of things by means of instrumenting piles for the vibro driving. So I finished. I hope it was interesting and for your profit. I see there's a couple of questions. I think I already discussed those questions. For example, indeed, PDM is monitoring the energy which is entering the pile, and this is one of the main checks we do. It can guarantee that the hammer is working properly, and as we just showed, it also can provide you some assurance of the fact that you are not damaging the pile with certain time limits. There's another question, very interesting, if there is any limitations for the pile diameter, length, thickness, diameter. I would say no, there's no limits. You can use this technique on small piles, large piles. It's been used for traditionally offshore piles up to some meters. It is use it currently to on large offshore monopiles up to 8 meters, 6 meters, and something like that. You can also use it by instrumenting your piles at different levels. For example, in the case of monopiles, this is very interesting because it allows you to instrument piles, for example, at the pile head, and as well far from the pile head in the pile. Think, for example, to the conical transitions of monopiles. It gets you measuring how the energy is distributed along the pile, if there's energy reflected before it reaches the soil. So you can instrument in many ways. It's very flexible methodology and very adaptable to the actual case you have. Regarding case history one, there's a question asking what period you recommend between the end of driving and restrike. If this is ground specific, I would say yes. I would say yes. It's a compromise between the likelihood that you need for the estimate of the line, how it is evolving in time. Clearly, it's easy to understand that if you do in short time after the end of driving, it will be subject to a relatively important error in the estimate, and progressively, if you wait, it will be more precise. At the same time, waiting time offshore require cost. So unfortunately, it's by means of the measurements that you can decide it. It can be very variable, as we've seen in the plot I showed, and it requires a case-by-case study. And it depends, for example, how far you are from the capacity and the end of driving, if the type of material, if you can allow, for example, for safely reaching the ultimate capacity, for example, by taking the lower bound of the data. It depends. There's no guidance. It has to be designed case by case in a procedure. About the glued PDM sensors, PDM sensors glued are very delicate. It's not the standard procedure. As I said, it is requiring a detailed planning and design before. It is indeed require a special preparation of the surface because it is glue, and so if you glue on something which is not firm, it's not working, but it can be done with relatively standard methodologies for cleaning surfaces, and you can use as well glue that is special performing for the dynamic solicitation. The surface can be prepared by your engineers. We prefer to do that ourselves because that allows us to guarantee that the procedure is applied correctly. But it depends. It depends. So we can organize that with your people. We have examples of comparison of drivability study for PDA and vibro hammers. For what is regarding impact hammers, there's a lot of literature. For what is regarding vibro hammers, there's not much of literature on this specific subject. We have data, but data at the moment are property of our clients, so we can't, unfortunately, share those, but we have data, yes. About preference, there's another question which is asking about a preference with regards to bolted or glued option. I would say, technically speaking, the bolted one is the standard, and it is the one which is providing the simplest and best performing solution. The glued is something which is not so easy to be applied. It is not so straightforward. So indeed, if there is any constraint, the bolted one will be preferable. Glue should be on uncoated areas, yes, preferably, because we need to grip on the steel. And then how many positions, orientations you need when you apply sensors. It's normally applied in pairs. So you have 2, 4, 6, 8. It depends essentially on the diameter and on the type of piles, the position of the welds. There's no unique solution. It is very rare that, for example, in the offshore, you apply only one position. You normally apply at a minimum of 2 positions, the sensors, and then you scale up in pairs, 4, never seen 3, for example. What percentage of offshore pile driving projects use PDM? I would say I'm not informed globally. It's something which is it depends also on engineering tradition. For example, in the United States, it's used a lot. In other countries, it's used less because in some cases, for example, in the onshore, driven piles are not used. That comes from traditions. For example, in some countries, drilled piles, concrete piles are more used. In there are countries, for example, they use wood piles. There are countries where they use driven piles of preference. It's very variable. It's very variable. Normally, it's the market has a very variable penetration in this sense. I can't give you figures about that. How accurate are the bearing capacity predictions? They are quite accurate. I would say 90%, 100% accurate. It depends, luckily enough for us, on how you do the installation of the sensors, how accurate and how straight and precise you are in applying the procedure. We unfortunately observe that in many cases PDM is not applied. The client is not happy, is thinking that PDM is just rubbish. When we were called to apply our capacity and expertise in third parties review of situations like that, what it came out is that the methodology was not applied correctly. For example, we know that we are in many cases pestering our clients with our emails to have the instruments, the holes, and all the procedure applied strictly. And in some cases, the client is not really happy of that at the beginning, but it is at the end, because this is actually making the PDM a very good methodology. So it is accurate. To be accurate as everything, you have to be correct, and you have to be strictly fulfilling what is the methodology. It's measurements which are quite delicate, because we, for example, are speaking of very small deformations with very high accelerations. Instruments are solicited a lot. Also the cables, for example, are solicited a lot. When you have 100 or 200 or 300 G's of acceleration, means that at that moment, for an instant, but the cables, the bolts will weigh 300-400 times their static weight, which is causing also problems, because if the connections, for example, are damaged, the data will not be accurate, and you won't have your capacity predicted as it can be if the instruments are installed correctly. So it's quite accurate in conclusion, but you have to apply it correctly. About fiber optic and technology, it's a very promising technology. It is, I'm not saying today a standard, but it is becoming applied day by day more. It's providing, for example, a very substantial advantage is that there's no electricity, and so it's reducing a lot of problems in working with water around. This is a nice advantage. Fiber optic instruments are performing quite well. It's not yet totally at the level of electric instrument that we use today. In particular, it is for the strains. It works very well. For the acceleration, it's not still at the height which is required. And this is why we need to mix up today fiber optic and other types of instruments. Let's say our traditional electric instruments, is because the fiber optic sensors in particular are not today developed at the height, let's say, at the level and the sophistication of the instruments that we have based on electricity. In any case, it is very promising, because the reliability of the fiber optics is good. The other important advantage of the fiber optic is the size. Indeed, the size of the instrument, the sensors of the fiber optic, is very, very small, which is allowing you to put instruments where normally electric ones, which are bigger, are a bit more complicated to be installed. It is simpler to protect. So it's a very promising technology. I don't know if I replied to what was behind your question. In research and development, yes, we are thinking about that. We are developing the use of fiber optic according to results of our research on this sector, in particular for the piloted buckling. Yes. Wireless sensors. We used wireless sensors. We tend to keep the use of wireless sensors at the minimum, because the possible interferences. There's a lot of steel where we operate, and steel can be annoying when you have radio waves, even if short wavelength. And so at the moment, we know about this technology. Our clients are asking for that, but we tend still today to rely on cables, also because in many cases we are, for the offshore wind in particular, we are required to install a lot of sensors, because the precision in the PDM and in the estimate of the pile capacity is becoming higher and higher. And so in some cases you need to install additional sensors, for example, and this is easier if you use cables, and in many cases our clients are asking us to grant 100% reliability, and at the moment we make more confidence to the cables than to the wireless sensors, which is indeed a very interesting interesting technology.
Okay, great. Thank you, Emilio. I think that's all of the questions we've got there. Thank you all for joining today. We've run over a little bit, so we'll wrap up there, and we hope you've enjoyed the webinar. Over the next few days, we'll share a copy of the recording with you and also a link to a short questionnaire if you'd like to give us any feedback. But in the meantime, if you'd like any more information on GeoctopUS or pile driving monitoring, there's some contact details on the screen there, so please get in touch or visit the website. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much from my side as well, and have a good day.